Well, God bless everybody this evening. Amen. It's good to be here in the house of God. It's Friday, and it's time to get into the Word of God. Before we get started, I want to thank those of you that have made it today, those that are here sitting at the table with us, Brother Saul, Sister Rita, those that are in the church here. We're going to say a word of prayer before we get into our little topic here. So if you would just bow your heads. Father, I just thank you, Lord, that once again you allowed us to be here in the house of God, in your house, Father, that we would be able to refresh our soul, refresh our spirit, Heavenly Father, with your word, Father. Allow your word to get down into our hearts, Father, so that we can use it, Father, not only today, but for the day of tomorrow, maybe for a conversation we're going to have this coming weekend or maybe next week, Father. I love you and I thank you for everything that you've already set and you've prepared ahead of time, Lord Jesus. I give you honor, I give you praise, and give Pastor Traveling mercies. She said she's on the way. She called me earlier. So don't drive too fast, Pastor. It's okay. We're giving you a chance to get here late. So we love you. In the mighty name of Jesus, we say amen and amen. 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 How funny, huh? My mom calling me to tell me I'm going to be late, mijo. Usually it's the other way around. Pastor's never late. But God is good. The last time we were talking about love. Love is patient, right? Love is patient. If I keep my mouth shut just for a little while, while you finish saying, even though you're making me mad, I'm going to be patient. That's love, right? It's the opposite of that is what? Is like, man, I'm going to let you have it, right? I'm not even going to let you finish saying what you're going to say. I'm just going to let you have it. That's the opposite of. But today, we are going to be talking about love is
kind.
Amen? Amen. Yeah. Love is kind. And there's a difference, right? Patience avoids a problem. You know that? I'm going to just be patient and I'm going to avoid the problem, right? But kindness is love in action. You have to do something in order to be kind. Okay?
Without being told.
Ooh. So, kindness is a part of my life that I do without her reminding me to do it. Mm-hmm. Right? It's just who I am. It's kindness. Patience avoids a problem, and kindness creates a blessing. When I'm kind, right? If I'm nice to you, even though maybe I should give you a piece of my mind, I'm probably going to set up a better day versus saying something and then starting the whole day off wrong. Right? Love is kind. You want to read your verse now?
Yeah, we'll read the verse.
Let's go. We're going to be in the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verses 3 and verse 4. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 4.
And it reads, "Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on a tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man."
Amen. My Bible says, never let loyalty and kindness get away from you. God gave me this woman right here. Right? This last Friday and the first Friday is focused on marriages. And how can the Word of God help me with my marriage today? Yes. And we're talking about loyalty. We're talking about kindness. I need to be kind to her without her telling me. Are you going to say thank you?
Are you going to say please?
Are you going to pick up your socks off the floor? Huh? Are you going to help me with the dishes? Because kindness would be just doing it because you know it needs to be done. That's just being kind. Right? Just doing it. You know it needs to be done. Nobody else is going to do it. If your spouse is already overwhelmed, you see that maybe the day has brought some issues up, and maybe there was a bad day at work. Well, then I can be kind by maybe helping to take the focus off of what happened at work. That's kind, right? That's what God wants from me in this marriage. Because the alternative, and that's me, right? Brother Tommy likes to always look at the opposite, right? The alternative of me helping her take the bad day away is to just let it fester. And it could create, it could become something bigger, right? It could become something bigger. So never let loyalty and kindness get away from you. Wear them like a necklace. Tie them around your neck. That means you're not supposed to ever let kindness go. It has to become part of your character. It has to be part of just what you do. Amen? So it says here in my notes, when you're kind to people, they want you to be around. When you're a nice person, people want you to be around. They see you as being good to them and being good for them, right? My mom, everybody's mom used to say, dime con quien andas. Tell me who you hang around with, and I'll tell you whether they're good for you or not. Running around, getting into trouble, up to no good. When you're a nice person and you show kindness, especially to this person that God placed in your life, right? Mm-hmm. That's what God wants from us. One of the things that me and my wife have been just lingering on, marinating on throughout the last couple of years is this focus of being a couple with a purpose. God brought me to her and her to me so that we can reach people for the Lord. That's our purpose. We're divinely purposed to be a power couple. That's what my wife said. So when I get love, when I get patience, kindness, and we constantly practice that in our marriage, it starts to rub off onto other people. Hey, you know what? You guys want to go to dinner? I love going to dinner. If you haven't noticed. I love going to dinner. But I also love talking about the Word of God. Yeah. I also love talking about how the Lord can help us. No matter where we're at in our relationship. No matter where we're at. Right? I am very grateful that God has taken something that was all messed up, and I'm talking about me, right? I'm not talking about you. My life was so messed up, heading in a bad direction, God turned that around. And now people want us to be around, right? They're not hiding their wallet in their purse when I go to their house.
It's not only that, not only hiding your wallet in your purse and your good stuff, your jewelry and what have you, it's the words. I know when kind words are spoken, when I'm around this person, I want to hear kind words. I want to hear nothing negative. I don't want to hear nothing where it's like I'm getting bashed on. And it's like, why do I want to hang out with you if all you're going to do is just throw mud or darts and all this ugliness at me? Why does anybody want to be around? Mm-hmm. Why? That's not what Jesus teaches or preaches. He's always been about love and kindness. Even when people were coming against him, he was still showed kindness. He still showed love. And that's something else, too. It's like with us, we weren't always kind. We weren't always kind to others. Yes, I was not. I was a peach to some people. But at the same time, we weren't kind to each other. We didn't. There was times where we didn't like each other. We didn't. But I don't know, was it torture to each other or something? I guess, because even though we weren't kind to each other, we still were around each other, knowing that, okay, God's going to do something. But once again, why do I want to be around you if you're not being kind? I just, no, let me I go to the gym. I go hang out with the kids or whoever, whatever, just to get away when you were stuck in your days of drinking. We didn't want to be around him.
Would you say that it's like my marriage is the same thing? In my mind, I think the guy had a plan.
Yeah.
He had a plan. Because for my wife, she stayed with me. Had to be God, isn't it?
Had to be.
It had to be God. You were saying it had to be God for you to stay with that man.
It has to be.
Yeah,
I mean,
but he has another plan. He put it together. And today, it's working.
Oh, it is. It is.
Good. We've been married 55.
Amen.
55 years, but 20 years was tough. For her, mm-hmm. How would you be?
Yeah.
Or she just hung out with me. I mean, didn't want to let go, and yet it was him. Now I realize it was him.
It was all the time.
I don't want to take that away from me because I know. And the kindness thing is powerful. It's powerful. It works. It works.
And it's something that we have to learn. Because coming from our life in sin, one of the ways that I describe it is we're selfish, and all we want to do is please ourselves.
Yeah.
Even though we're married, I want what's best for me, even though we're married. And when you're kind, there's no selfishness in kindness, right? I'm doing it because I want her to feel better. Yeah. I'm doing it because her day was bad, I recognize it, and I want to show God's love, right? And that's God working through me to help the situation. There's no selfishness when it comes to kindness, right? Out serving each other. If it needs to be done, just do it, right?
Let's do it.
If you didn't grow up doing laundry, maybe it's time to learn. Uh-oh.
Well, I do laundry now. I do laundry now. I wash dishes too.
Yeah, good for you.
No,
good for you.
But it, being kind to me, I enjoy now being kind to you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. It's because I like to see the smile on his face and the smile on his heart. Even though he might not be smiling in his face, I can tell he's the happiness. I can see the light.
Yes.
And that's what I enjoy. That's what makes me happy, is to see him happy. And being kind and being not so rude and whatever. Just being kind to you. That's what I enjoyed. Watching you smile, seeing you smile, seeing that like, she loves me.
Yeah. God has taken our relationship, and it is becoming something that is very beautiful. I can say that, right? Now, many people will make an observation on the way they see us, but we've been very intimate with each other. Good intimate, bad intimate. We've been with each other for 32 years, right?
Let me see. Is that right?
I should have had you hold up the board, huh?
32?
It's 32 years of being together. 33 coming up on 4th of July.
We got together
on 4th of July.
Oh, okay.
So she snuck up on me. I was lighting firecrackers.
Don't listen to him.
She scared me and I got scared.
Yeah, I was just talking to somebody about this too the other day.
On Monday, we will be married 30 years. 30 years, we will have been married. It's been a long road. And if it was not for God,
had not been for Jesus.
Yes.
If it had not been for the Lord, if it had not been for the prayers of mom and dad,
that's
if it had
right.
not been for the prayers of the body of Christ,
right.
if it had not been for the prayers of a mother and for a wife that was looking for something better, who knows where we would be, right? But the prayers of a righteous individual availeth much, is what the Bible says.
Yes.
And God hears you on the first time.
Mm-hmm.
We get tired of waiting, but God heard you. We just have to learn to be patient.
Yeah.
Take our hands off the situation and let God deal with it. That way we don't get in trouble.
The patience and the kindness, they do go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Because in order to be kind, you got to be patient. Even in the situation is hard and tough and you're going through it, through whatever valley you're going through, whether it be not being so intimate in a vulnerable way, and or if it's the finances, whatever the case may be, you guys know your marriage, you know what it's like and what you need, whatever valley you're going through, it just being patient. I know there's times where it was the valleys we've been in, it's just being patient and waiting, and at the same time, being kind. Mm-hmm. I always remember what Auntie Becky used to say when he wasn't going, but I started serving, was whatever you do, make sure you don't give him room to tell you no. Just show love. And it was okay. I didn't think about it then, but now I think about it, it was just, I was patient. I was so patient. And even though there was times where it was like, I'm done, I can't do this no more. I had the house packed up and everything. I could have snuck out and he wouldn't even know. Could have got a moving.
I would have found you.
No, I could have got a moving truck and just been like,
I would have found you.
Gone. Try to hide wherever, however. But I was just patient. And even when he would come home, there was days where it was like, ooh, you don't know how bad I want to hit you with this frying pan. He hadn't been home for almost a week, and but I was still there, and me just being patient, showing kindness, so that when he came home, this was his safe place. Even though you were wherever you were at, this was your safe place. This is your safe place. I am your safe place. Mm-hmm. So that he recognized and knew, and I knew that day was gonna come, even though there was days where it's like, I don't see it, Lord. I don't see it through all this storm. But that was fine because I still stuck by there. And I know there's, we're women, we don't wanna just, okay, we wanna see results now. We wanna see that the situation and the results and the blessings now. But there's a time.
One of the things that we learn as believers, okay, is that God wants us to be uncomfortable. Because mm-hmm. when you're comfortable, you're not seeking God.
Yes.
When you're okay with where you're at, something's wrong.
Yes.
God wants you to run to Him.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
God wants you to be uncomfortable. I don't know how to deal with this, Lord. I need your help. That's what He wants. Mm-hmm. But when you're comfortable, I got my routine, right? My show comes on, it's on record already, and I'm just going to watch, I don't know, my mom likes General Hospital worship.
Mm, that's that one.
Right? When you're in your routine, that's when something's not right. We have to continue be pressing into the Lord, the presence of God. Press into the presence of God. Press into. Oh. Pastor heard me talking about.
I told not to touch that.
Ever since I was small, Luke and Laura. The other day I was watching, I'm like, who's that? She goes, that's Laura. I go, Laura's gained a lot of weight. I remember Scorpio and I don't even know. Who was I telling? My mom and my grandma used to sit and watch General Hospital, and they would clean beans on the table. They were taking the rocks out and the broken ones, and they would. My grandma had her apron on, and they would be cleaning it. A little example, or just between patience and kindness. One is preventative, like patience. When I have patience, I am preventing a problem.
Yes, you are.
Patience. Mm-hmm. So patience is preventative, and the other one, kindness, is proactive. Mm-hmm. It takes initiative on your part. Mm-hmm. Even though you had a bad day too, maybe you still need to do something kind.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Kindness is about doing something first. We have to do something first. If it needs to be done, you need to be the one to do it. What's that?
I pulled up a scripture.
What do you got, sister?
I got Proverbs 3, verse 27. Do not withhold good from those to whom it is due, when it is in the power of your hands to do so.
Amen. Good. There's another scripture that says, take every opportunity to do good.
Yeah.
Don't waste it.
Make the most of every opportunity.
Make the most of every opportunity. We are what? We are ambassadors
of Christ.
Of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Yeah.
When I think about doing kindness without being asked, I think about John 3:16.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He loved us for rainbow.
I know. Mm-hmm.
We didn't have to earn it.
No.
We can never earn the love God has for us.
Yeah.
He gave it to us before we even realized He was giving it to us.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? And that's kindness. That's love. He's patient with us, and He's so kind to us. He does for us before we even ask. He's already setting up the situation.
Yeah.
Yeah, He's ready for us.
He's ready.
He's like Adam and Eve. Everything was set for them. The garden of Eden.
Set.
Everything was set for them.
Set up.
Then He made them. And He set the garden up first.
Prepared up.
Prepared up.
Yeah.
So how much more do you not think that how much kind He is to us, even though we mess up, even though we slip, even though we sin and once again, we slip and fall. But He still sets up. He still has our future, our today,
yes.
Our tomorrow, our yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He has that set. And everything that we pray for, we ask God for our children, for not even our blessings, just for our children and our family and our loved ones, and give us strength and our healing. That don't you think He has that in control? Has that already for us?
He's
just waiting for us to once again get into Him, sit at His feet, and just soak in His presence. Do what He asks us to do. And He doesn't demand so much from us. He's not asking a whole lot from us. He's just asking us to follow His example, to love, be patient, kind. Even when they're not nice to us,
just be nice.
Just be nice. Just be kind. It is the hardest thing in the world to get. Don't get me wrong. It is hard, but it's harder when we're not. Because then guess what? Like my husband said some years ago, we just got to retake that test again.
Yep.
Like we told our son, if we're not winning, we're learning. We got to retake that test all over again.
Yep.
How many times are we going to retake the test after He's told us and tells us time and time again? After His message is being preached time and time again, every Sunday, Friday service, every moment we're getting to our word, He's telling us, and we got to retake the test because why? We weren't kind. We weren't nice. We weren't patient.
Yeah.
We didn't stop to, I know now it's, even before I would, when we would get in disagreements and arguments, I would just bite back. I'm biting back. I'm talking back. Whatever. But now it's just like, Lord, give me the words to speak. Even if it's not right now at this moment that I tell Him how He either made me feel or what He said was wrong or whatever the situation is, that Lord, give me the words.
Mm-hmm.
And then He brings it at the right time when we're both leveled,
mm-hmm,
and eye to eye with each other, not one's higher than the other. We're just both in the same mind, in the presence. Then that's when God, I've noticed, gave me the words to be like, hey, you know what? You didn't, what you said here, what you did here, it wasn't right. And no, I know for a fact that this wasn't, and God will minister, because that's my prayer, is Lord, give me the words, prepare His heart to hear and receive that He's hearing you, not me. Not me, let it be you He's hearing.
So when we're patient, and this is the season that God has me and my wife in, we have to be patient with each other, because guess what? In a month or two, we're going to have to be patient with other people too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we got to learn the lesson, brother. If we don't learn the lesson here at home with each other, in front of people in public, we're going to fail the test. And that's when it's going to be bad. I don't want to fail the test. So I need to learn. And as we allow God to set up the atmosphere, to set up the situation, things can come out, things can be dealt with, but we have to be patient and wait on God. One of the times you go ahead, with sister.
Me is, I shut down right away.
Well, don't do that no more.
And I have to say I still do because I know my mouth, I can say something that's going to be very hurtful, and I don't want to do that because then, to be honest with you, I never think I've ever told him I'm sorry for any. Well, to me, I feel that, I mean, I'm not perfect, but he's done a lot to me, and I've never, you know, retaliated or anything like that, but I just don't say anything because I don't want to say something that I can be very hateful, you know.
So don't you think that by praying and asking God to give you the words to talk to your husband, that he will give you the words to talk to him, but at the same time, Lord, give me the words, but prepare his heart to hear you? Like I said, give me the words, but prepare his heart that he hears you and not hear the anger, the bitterness, the resentment, the tone, the attitude.
It all matters, huh?
It's all that. Remove all that, Lord. The attitude, the tone, the bitterness, the resentment, the anger, the hurtfulness. Remove all that needs to be, because you're the only one that knows what needs to be removed.
Right.
We have a lot of stuff that needs to be removed, and let him hear you. Give me the words to speak to him, and let him hear. But at the same time, Lord, prepare my heart for whatever he has to say to me.
And for him to listen to me before he says anything.
To hear it all?
Sometimes I can say things and he'll say something, it'll make me mad, and I'll stop and I won't say nothing.
So we've been, it's already like not 2 years ago, right? We talked about active listening.
Yeah.
Active listening is listening. Not waiting for my chance to get back at you because you're not listening, right? Or just throwing stuff back and forth. So these are things that the Holy Spirit allows us to recognize so that we can stop it. So God is doing something.
Remember that one?
Yep.
Remember?
The microphone?
When I have this, I have the floor. And until I put it down, you need to just listen. Sometimes We learned that in a couples counseling. Me and my wife went to couples counseling, right? And it doesn't matter. There is so much good information out there, but the Holy Spirit lives in us.
Right, man.
The Holy Spirit lives in us and tells us, quickens us.
Yes.
Sister Rita, as you spend time with God, he'll tell you, all right, Lord, pray that God will help whatever situation that is. That's between you and God. But the Holy Spirit quickens you, quickens your spouse. And you guys on an individual basis need to work on that. Because as you're spending time with God, you're meditating, you're praying, God will help us. But that's what he wants, right? He wants us to run to him for everything.
Now, is it hard? Question, is it hard for you to say what has to be said because you're afraid of his reaction?
Yeah.
Or is it the words that you're trying to get out that you don't want him to?
I'm afraid of what he's going to say or you know, how he's going to react.
Okay.
Can I give you a little advice of what I used to do? A little advice. Years back, and I'm not the only one that did this. My son did this too. We used to write in a journal. And I would write in a journal, and I would leave it out on purpose so that he can read it. And my son did the same thing too. And I didn't know this, that my son did this. I didn't know this. And he told me this sometime last year. He goes, Mom, do you know I used to write in a journal, and I used to leave it out, hoping and praying that Dad would see it and read it. And it just like, I used to do the same thing, son. And he was just like, but I don't think Dad ever seen it.
I don't think Dad ever seen it.
And it really shocked me Because like I said,
you would be happy filled because you didn't read it.
Sister Rita, I am still dealing with all that.
Yeah.
Now here's the meat of my situation. Because I refuse to even put my finger on the fact that I was being the worst father in the world, I thought I was okay. I was comfortable, right? I'm still dealing with some of that stuff. And our prayer is that our son would become saved, would accept salvation into his life, and his whole family, you know, would come. That's our prayer. But, Sister Rita, the choices that I made in the past, right? The consequences. Adam and Eve made a choice, and they had consequences. They got kicked out of the Garden of Eden. Women are have birth pains. Men have to work the rest of their life. That was not the plan of God. But there are consequences. Yes. And the Holy Spirit lives in our life now to tell us and to quicken us so that we don't continue to make mistakes. Yes. Sister Lorraine.
Your son is watching everything you guys are doing.
Sure he is.
So when you say...
Sane also.
Yeah, and sane as well. So... Yeah, he's seen the other part of you a long time ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
But and in God's timing, he's going to see the life that you guys are living like right now.
Yes, ma'am.
And until whenever, and your son's going to be here.
Yes.
No matter what. But he's probably just checking you guys out.
Testing. And that's okay. Is it a phase? Right?
That's
are you just pretending to be Christian
because,
now?
Because, yeah, right? Exactly. Because, see, I'll say for myself. We came, we left, and then we came back. So, I'm saying backslid. So I backslid, and if my kids seen the part that I lived back then, and they're saying, oh, okay. So they tested me. Even my dad did. My dad even tested me and Albert, because he said one time when we were at my mother-in-law's, and he said, it was New Year's, and he said, where are you guys going? Because we got all dressed, we were living with Albert's mom. He says, where are you guys going? Because he was sitting there drinking with Albert's dad. And he said, where are you going, Lorraine? I said, I'm going to church, Dad. And he said, So he was watching our walk. And one day he showed us both. You guys are true.
Amen.
What you have done with your life, it's true. These other ones, I could see that they just play with God. Mm. They're just playing.
And it happens.
Yeah. But with you guys, your son is watching every detail. And that's what ours does.
If we're not careful, we could hurt him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If we're not careful with our words,
mm-hmm.
if we weren't patient on the Lord setting up the atmosphere.
We're kind.
Again, the lessons that I learned here mm-hmm. are going to affect every relationship that I have.
Mm-hmm.
God's trying to teach us something. So the lessons that you're supposed to be learning one with another, they're going to affect other relationships.
You know, I think about this, but and this is my thoughts, you know, it's like if I do something and he tells me something that I don't like to hear.
Sure.
You know, I know you. He does know me. But that was the old me.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't want to recognize the new me that I'm trying to do. You
sounds
know?
Like my son.
And that hurts. Because I'm trying to do that for not just for me, for my whole family, you know. And I don't know if it's not forgiving me, not trusting me, you know. But what she's saying is right. She mm-hmm. knows me. He knew the old me.
Mm-hmm.
He referred to the old me now. I am not that. I am a new creation now.
Amen.
You know? I mean, I'm going to make mistakes along the line, you know? And before I can say anything, she won't let me finish.
Yeah.
And that kind of upsets me. Well, you know?
So the lesson about being patient,
mm-hmm.
that's the part that we have to get down.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be patient with her because she's still learning.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to be patient with him because he's still learning. And that's the part that we have to pass that test. If not, we're not going to go nowhere.
And being kind to each other, even when you see the slip-ups, even when I see the slip-ups or the falls, mm-hmm. when I see those, I'm not going to be right away, go, see, look what you did. Mm-hmm. Why did you go and say that? Or why did you do this? And did you see how you did this? And that? I'm not pointing it out to him of all the things that he has on him. I'm not going to do that. As his partner, as his wife, as his power team, I'm going to sit here and protect my husband. Because that's what we do. As a power couple, you got to protect your marriage. You got to protect your spouse. That is the one thing that we have to do. Because as it is, the whole world out there is ready to devour them, ready to chop them up, eat them up, and spit them out.
We can't be the ones with our gun loaded to blast them every chance we get. Mm-hmm. No, the world is already doing that.
Speaking evil
towards we can't be that person. That's not what God wants us to do.
We're a new creation.
We're a new creation.
As the brother said, you know, the old...
It's gone.
I call it the old priest. Before Christ.
Before Christ.
Yeah, mm-hmm. that was before Christ. But we are new people now. We got to think like that.
Yes,
and
we do.
Some of the things I think, agree with me, that's wrong with the church, not this church, all churches in general.
Sure.
Is that they don't know how God sees them.
Mm. Amen.
And they don't know who they are in Christ.
Yeah. Yes.
Once you get that patent down, who they are in Christ and how God sees you, how does he see you? They see me always like a sinner, always messed up, always complaining. Does that really see you?
No, he sees you beautiful.
See, but you have to know that, you have to read it, you have to study on that, how he sees you. And when you know how he sees you, you're going to think differently yourself.
Yes.
And then you get to know who you are in Christ.
So,
what did you do those two?
My wife says, you know, she has to see me as a godson.
Amen.
I have to see her as a daughter of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you'll approach everything different. But like Brother Sam was saying, we have to know that she's a child of the King. So am I. And we're a work in progress. We're a work in progress. We have to understand that. Love and kindness. Sometimes, though, and this is the part, and whether one person does it or the other one does it, my notes say, a kind husband or a wife will be the one who greets first. Like, you can be the first one to say good morning.
Yeah.
You can be the first one to say, hi, how you been? That's the kind person. Don't just wait. Are you going to say anything? No, we have to be the first one. We have to be. The first one that smiles, the first one that serves, and the first one that forgives. That's somebody who's kind. We have to be the first. Outdo each other being nice. Man, if you do that, we'll be all right. We'll be all right.
It can make it, I don't know, like you said, outdo each other. Yeah, do I want to outdo the years that he's been nice to me, kind to me? Do I want to outdo that? It's kind of like a competition. Oh, I was nice to you, but it's not keeping score. It's just like, oh, I was nice to him on this. I did this for him. I got him his early anniversary present, which he won't get until his anniversary, but I already ordered it. It's good. We're good. And then on that, yeah, but then now it's like, what's he going to do for me? But then at the same time,
I started buying her stuff like 3 days ago.
But not only that, it's kind of like in, okay, well, why? I know my daughter is always big on Valentine's Day about Valentine's Day should not just be one day. We got to love all days, right?
All the time.
So why do I just want one day of just showing, being nice and being loving and spoiling? We need to spoil each other. Being kind. I know, waking up in the mornings, when I leave, I always, okay, I'll be back. And he's asleep, but I'm out the door and I let him know. I'm home, I'm back. Greeting him in that way of good morning. All right, I'll be back.
Be the first.
Yes, why not?
Be the first. Why not? My notes say, when acting from kindness, you see the need and then you quickly make your move first.
Action.
That's being kind, right? It takes maybe a character change.
Yeah.
Maybe it takes a mind change.
Yes.
But we serve a God that is all powerful.
That's right.
Who can take something from nothing and turn it into something.
Yes.
Who can take something that was dead and bring it back to life.
Mm-hmm. You know what I like on Caleb? Is if you can't find a nice person, be one.
Ooh, I like that. But I mean, if you start your morning out being kind to your partner, and you go out the door, and then you notice you're kind to everybody else that you run into.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Good morning. I know when I see people, and sometimes I'm like that. Once again, I'm a peach. I'm such a peach that I don't like to smile too much at people because they told them no. It gives people the she wants to talk to me. No, I don't want her to talk. But now it's when I know when I'm kind to him and I go out and smile at people more. And it's like, oh, good morning, have a good day, have a blessed day. And I'm hearing that a lot more today than I have in the past. I'll be blessed. And it's like, whether they know I go to church or not, it doesn't matter. It's, you know what, amen, because there's more kind people out there, but it's like that smile, right? When they say you smile, then everybody else starts smiling.
Contagious.
It is very, very contagious.
You know, and I caught myself doing that a lot lately too, like, you know, when you go to the store or something, or somebody there says, yeah, okay, God bless you, or, you know, like Michelle the other day, before she had this done yesterday, she went to Kaiser and she didn't have no money on her cash. Somebody used her card and she's still waiting for it to come in.
Mm.
She didn't have money to pay for her pills. And the girl, young girl behind her told her, she goes, oh, how much is it? It was only $16. And then she told her, she goes, oh, I'll pay for it. And Michelle goes, oh, you don't have to do that. And she goes, no, I want you. So she says, oh, good. I mean, God bless you. And, you know,
There is good people out there, and there's people that you run into that you don't even like at Starbucks. You know how when people buy the next car behind you coffee?
Yeah.
Doing something like that, you know, you don't know what they're going through. You don't know how their day started. You don't know. I remember seeing a post on one of the medias, and it really, really touched my heart. You see this coffee shop, and it was one of those drive-through ones, where it was a picture of these three young men reaching over into the car to the lady that was in the car. And she was a regular, but they noticed that something was wrong with her. Something was wrong with her. She wasn't her normal, cheerful self. And when the barista asked her, like, hey, how you doing? And I just lost my husband.
Mm-hmm.
And she's going through it. Well, the baristas felt that urge to reach out and pray for her. So when they posted this on the media, the manager was just like, hey, that's my shop. Hey, that's so-and-so. And they talked to those gentlemen, and they were young guys. They weren't like in their 20s. They were like in high school. And they said, when we seen it, she said that she had just lost her husband, that, you know, she wasn't having a good day because she had just lost her husband. We had that felt the urge to pray for her because she was hurting. And whether it was, you know what, don't even pay for your coffee, just have a blessed day, we're praying for you. That was the urge. That's the kindness right there. Because once again, we don't know what the next person's going through. Once again, when he comes home from work, I know what kind of day he has sometimes, because I'll get texts, pray for me, give me a prayer. And I'm like, oh man, it's going to be a good one when you get home. And I'll pray for him right away. And once again, when I come home and he sees it, that I'm just... he could see it in my face. We could see it in each other that I'm not just physically drained, emotionally drained, mentally drained. You could see it in the person's face. You could see it in their walk, their demeanor, their everything. You could see, he could see it in me. He could see it, tell something's wrong. So he's just gonna just, I tell him, give me 5 minutes. The next thing you know, it's like 2 hours later, and I was like, whoa, what happened to 5 minutes? But that's he sees it. He recognizes it. I know he's praying for me right away, and he lets me have my moment. And even if it's a, come on, let's go get some, or let's go for a drive, or let's go to the store. And I know that's his way of letting to decompress, to just let's get away.
Decompress. sometimes we have to take a chance to unpack some of this stuff, especially with our spouse, because this is about marriages and beloved couples. But this is what the Word of God says in the book of Colossians. The book of Colossians, chapter 3, verse 12. And verse 13 is a good one too, but let's read verse 12 first. Okay. Colossians, chapter 3, verse 12. We got it? Ephesians, sure, Philippians, yeah, Colossians?
Colossians 3.
Yeah. Colossians 3, verse 12. We're talking about love, patience, kindness. And this is what the Word of God says. It says, since God chose you to be the holy people whom he loves, you must clothe yourself with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Mm. Clothe yourself. It has to be part of what you are. Mm-hmm. You have to get up and leave the house with kindness.
Yes.
You have to get up. Even though you take a shower, it can't come off because it's part of you. Clothe yourself. Right? Verse 13. Mm-hmm. What does verse 13 say?
That's a good one. Bearing with one another and forgiving one another.
Oh,
if anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do.
We have to forgive each other. We have to stop letting this petty stuff bother us to the point to where we're just mad and angry all the time. You cannot show love when you're mad and angry.
Mm-mm.
It doesn't work. Right? Oil and water don't mix. It just doesn't. Right? The Holy Spirit's not going to inhabit a temple that's full of garbage. It's just not.
Not only that, we're praying for our loved ones. We're praying for not just our loved ones, but once again, we have friends, we have family. Guess what they have? So it's like we're branching out, because when our kids come, who else do you think is going to follow them? Who do we think and know that God's going to bring into or has in their life right now? We have friends, they got family members, our children. Well, it's like the family tree, right? The family tree, you got your grandparents, and you got your mom and dad, then you got your siblings, and it goes on and on and on and on. It's the same thing with our kids. Our kids are gonna come, they bring their family, their friends, and it's branching out. But then when they come into church, our children, the enemy is going to use our children, because once again, he uses those that are closest to us to hurt us. If you cannot forgive your husband, how are you going to forgive your children that God's bringing into this church? How are you going to forgive those that have influenced your children?
Uh-oh.
That's the hardest one.
That's a hard one.
That's a hard one. I know that was a hard one. That's a hard one for me. How am I going to be that encourager, that example to my children's influencers?
Right.
When they're the ones that my sons and my children still talk to. They're the ones that they communicate to, but they're also the ones that are hurt themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So when my children come, then of course their friends are gonna, hey, you're serving God? Well, I need prayer. I need this, I need that. When they walk through those doors, is that furnace going to start warming up? Because it was like, oh, I know that's kind of a one of his friends that I'm like, don't really care for any of his old friends. I really don't. But when they walk through those doors, I can't show that. Because what am I going to do? I'm pushing them out the door.
Mm-hmm.
But who else am I going to push out the door? Who else am I going to push out the door when my children come in and bring their friends? The friends that I don't like. I didn't like back then because of how they influenced my children and how they pulled my children away from the church. How are you going to do that? How are you going to help forgive him when your people are coming? Their friends are coming. They're going to upset us. The past is going to get brought up. But we have to let it go and just be kind, patient, and loving and forgiving to our spouses, to our children, to their influencers. We have to.
Because it sounds just like a mom.
Once again, right? Once again.
We always think everybody's influencing
them. Yes.
But my kids, him
my kids are that way because of them. My kids.
I didn't see no broken arms.
My kids are angels. But that is true because
we're
pushing them out the door. And it's going to hurt us because then we ask them, why don't you want to go to church? When I brought my friend, how did you treat them?
Yeah.
When you talk and preach about love and patience and kindness, but yet when they walked in, I felt them darts coming out of your eyeballs and I wasn't
your
even in there.
So
everything came out.
We have to learn the lesson. Mm-hmm. The lesson of unforgiveness. We have to learn that lesson. Mm-hmm. Not just with, okay, I'll forgive them because I like them. But them, I'm holding that grudge. That doesn't work. It doesn't work. We have to learn the lesson of unforgiveness.
You said it's right and all that. In my life, with my kids, there were some bad kids over. But you know, they're older in the Word, about 65 years old. They're bringing kids over, but I don't have to go by what the Bible tells me. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to compromise with sin. Okay, my kids are bringing it, I'm going to talk to them. Mm-hmm. They know how I did that.
Yes.
They know I'm for real.
Yes.
They know that.
Amen.
So I sit down and I talk to Mel. The Bible says this isn't your parents. If I were to listen to my parents, I would have waited 40 years of that kind of life.
Yes.
The Bible says, listen to me. I've been there. I know at the point of what's waiting for you. I've been there. Listen to me. The Bible says, listen to me if you want a good life. Those guys are no good. Okay. They're not your friends. If anything breaks out, they'll leave you alone.
They'll run. Mm-hmm.
You're going to run. Trust me. Right now, I don't have a friend. The only friend I have is these guys right here now.
I got one friend.
I got one friend.
Yeah, my wife's my friend, but I'm talking about friends.
Yes.
Acquaintances.
They're all either dead, or I don't see them no more because they're still in the world.
Yeah.
If they come to my house, I'll talk to them about the word. Right. Mm-hmm. Some don't want to hear it. Some would. Leave it. Leave it like all that.
Bye.
Yeah. Okay. But my kids, that's why I do my kids. I talk to them, I tell them the truth. They're no good for you. They're going to take you down. They're going to break your family. They don't care about your family. Yeah. And so just listen to me.
Yeah.
And thank you, Jesus, that they listen to me.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
They listen to me. But I think if you sit down and talk to them and don't try to accept your friends as, well, they're your friends, okay. They don't come in then. Okay. They come into my house, but like you said, you know, they're going to expect.
These are the rules, yes.
You know, talk to them kindly, with love. Let them see me.
Yes.
Not preach to them, let them see how I walk.
Amen.
When you see how I walk, you know.
It'll make a bigger impact.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Some of those guys that you came around with, I don't give them.
The scripture, verse 12 said, with tender-hearted mercy. That's loving right there. Mm-hmm. Right? It goes on to say gentleness, but when you're being tender-hearted and you're being merciful to somebody, you're overlooking, you're being gentle, you're being cautious, and you're not going to hurt them, right? Gentleness. When you're operating from kindness, you're careful how you treat your spouse. It says, never being unnecessarily callous or harsh. You're supposed to be sensitive, tender. You speak the truth, but you do it in love. That's gentleness.
Yeah, that's good.
And it all goes back to the fruits of the Spirit, because in order for me to hold back, the way I used to be, I didn't hold back, but now I'm holding back. That's self-control. Isn't that one of the fruits of the Spirit? Self-control is one of the fruits of the Spirit.
Yeah.
And if you're so quick to just, oh man, oh, you just get me so mad, and we need prayer in our lives.
That's something what you said, it stuck on me all week. You said something you're talking about right now, but you said if that's where you live, something's wrong.
Something's wrong.
If you hit that, whoa, it hit you real hard. It's a little simple words. Something's wrong.
Something's wrong.
When you told me that, I'm going on that right now.
Amen.
But I don't know, these are those simple words, something's wrong. It gets hit me so hard.
It's deep, because it helps us to recognize there is something wrong. There is something wrong when I can't be kind, when I can't be patient towards my spouse, there's something wrong. Lord, it's not him. There's something wrong here. Once again, like he says, put your finger on it. We got to put our finger on what's wrong. I can't blame him. I can't blame my parents. I can't do any of that. I got to, okay, Lord, help me. I evaluate myself.
There's a piece of unforgiveness still there. Yes. That's still hiding deep within.
Yes.
That we need to root out.
Yes.
So that's what, I mean, that's what needs to be done. And I feel like, I don't want to be rude or anything, but I feel like, Sister Rita, maybe that's what needs to, you need to root that, whatever you're feeling.
We've dealt with
that. Because I know I felt it.
It's hard for me to talk to him to say what it is. And I mean, I know you kind of probably know, but I'm just scared what he's going to come back at.
Don't be scared, babe. You know? Let your heart be released.
And
get rid of it.
They say, you know, pray on it first.
Yeah.
You know, and
yes.
I have it, and then when it comes time where I want to, I don't do it.
So it's not only, and once again, let's dig deeper.
Yes.
We're going to dig deeper, because I know that was my hardest thing to do, is to dig deeper. Mm-hmm. It wasn't with him. It was with my past. There's something that was in my past that was hindering my future.
Like
we were suppressing so much, because that's what we've done for so many years. That's what we were taught. That's what we were taught, and that's what we taught our children. Yeah. I want to admit, I taught my children, what happens in home stays in home. You don't tell nobody about it.
Yeah.
So what do? They suppress it. So I suppress so much. So whatever happened in my past with my mom, with my dad, with my past, I had a past. Whatever happened there was hindering here.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the hardest thing to put my finger on it. And I'm thankful and grateful he gave me that book. That when I did come back from visiting our son last year, I dug into that book. And every day that I read that book, I had napkins and tissues. There was new ones over here, and there was mucoso ones over here, because that's all I did every time I read that book. But it was helpful for me, because now it's there. There's nothing that my past is my past. Yes. It's not hindering here no more, because I forgave my past, my hurt past. Mm-hmm. I forgave him, the past and the present. That it's, there's nothing there. So it's, once again, dig deeper. It's not just with him. There's something else that you suppressed that you don't want to bring it out. Because then it's the having to deal with it.
I mean,
this is what we have to do, right? Is individually, this is where our prayer closet and our time with the Lord allows us to get deep. You might have covered it up so much that you believe that it's not there no more. But it's there.
We want to believe it's not there.
But God loves us so much, and he has a plan for your life, but you cannot take any of that stuff that we've suppressed into this area where God wants you. So what happens is we just, like, we're flatlining. Yeah. We're not growing in the Lord, and we're not doing nothing because we haven't dug deeper. And again, we started this evening saying, God wants you uncomfortable. God wants you. That thing that you don't like to do, you get nervous about, that's where God wants you, because that's when you can deal with some of that stuff. Mm-hmm. No, I'm good. I'm all right. I'm going to stay over here. I'm okay. I don't want to say anything. No, well, God wants us to dig it out. And to be honest, sister, it has to be me, my choice. I have to want to stop using drugs. I have to want to stop drinking. I have to stop trying to be funny and just making everybody mad. Mm-hmm. Right? I thought I was a comedian. I thought I was...
No, you ain't,
you know?
Kevin Hart. You're not Kevin Hart.
But the Word of God says, right back to Proverbs, bind them around your neck.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
To write them on the tablet of your heart.
Yes.
How do you write them on the tablet of your heart?
Mm-hmm.
Psalms 91, King David said, my tongue is a pen of a ready writer.
Mm-hmm.
Your tongue, your words, you confess the Word of God and you write it on your heart.
Mm-hmm.
This is from the words. In Psalms 45:1. My tongue is a pen of a ready writer. It's the word that you speak. They confess the word of God, and that's how they get on the tablet of your heart.
This is what we should be speaking.
Yes.
Even if I have post-its. I have post-its, and I keep them in my here, because when a verse comes to mind, and I want to have this where I'm like using it as I speak, like we're learning on Mondays. So I write them down. I have one that's posted on my wall right there in front of me where I do my makeup so I can read it. And I want to post it all over. So that's what you see. When you see something visual,
right,
a consistent visual, it gets drilled in your head.
Yeah.
Remember flashcards? Remember the flashcards?
Yes. Right.
One plus one. One times one. And you kept doing it over and over and over that it got drilled in your head.
Yes.
So why don't we do that for our scriptures?
Yes.
Why not do that for our scriptures? Once again, write them, bind them up on your neck. That's how we're binding them up in our hearts and on our neck as a necklace, to have these scriptures out and just over and over and over. I don't mind doing it. The other book that I'm reading is, it talks about, what's the one that wrestled with the angel for his Jacob. He wrestled with the angel because he was determined, I'm gonna get my blessing. I'm determined. Yeah. And what did God do? What did God do with one touch? And we can't even do that, because once again, we got to get uncomfortable. Do you think it was comfortable for Jacob to wrestle with the angel and then get your hip
dislocated,
but still going at it?
I'm not letting you go.
Because I'm determined to get my blessings. And I don't care if you find a lash over here and a lash over here and hair looking a hot mess and looking like a raccoon. I don't mind. I will do that, and I will be in the most uncomfortable place and most uncomfortable way. We don't want to do that because we don't want to physically get hurt, but we have to physically. God's putting our spiritual body to death so that we can. What else is he going to do when he knocks that hip out? What else is he going to do? I was thinking about the retreat, not last year's retreat, the year before, when we went to the retreat, 2022. Mm-hmm. And when I read that part, that came to my mind. I came home and half of my hand was bruised.
Yeah.
Half of my hand was bruised. I had a swollen knee. What happened to you? There's something that happened to you, because there was three of us that came back.
My bug bite.
She had a bug bite, and there was somebody else that had something else. The three of us came home like
Tora.
Beat up. But when I read that, I said, that's what I want. I don't care about the bruised hand. I don't care about the swollen knee. I don't care about the broken toe or the hip getting out of place. As long as I'm going to sit there and wrestle against that angel to receive my blessing, my healing, my forgiveness, my kindness, my love, to receive what I need to receive from God so that others can see what he done here, he can do there. I'm going to wrestle with them to receive my blessings. I'm going to get uncomfortable, and I don't like it. I don't like it. It took me years for him to see me cry. I did it in the shower for years. Blamed it on the shampoo. Maybe he doesn't know how I wash my hair. He thinks I'm like getting all crazy. But I did it for years. And now I can cry in front of him. Now he recognizes when I'm hurt, when I'm sad, when I'm missing my child. He recognizes that.
That's God.
That is God.
I wanted God to be first in my life. And as I get closer to God, he allows me to get closer to her.
Yeah, abide in me, not abide in you. You have to abide in the Lord. And say the truth. Everything in the cross, it was finished. All the blessings and all the promises are yours.
Exactly.
They're already yours. They're in your spirit. Our job is to get the promises from the spirit into our physical bodies. And
there's stuff blocking.
That is
another thing. Thank God, you know. Is our mind our unforgiveness?
That's all that work. Like, once again, we're the ones that are blocking our blessings and prolonging our our blessings.
We're in the way we're
bumping. Because once again, God has it. It's like marching around the There you go. Thank you. I couldn't even think about it. I want to say castle, but it wasn't that. We're marching around it. We're marching around it, right? We're on the sixth one, going on to seven, but then we stop because
we're uncomfortable.
We're uncomfortable, and our minds are overworking.
My junk glasses are broken.
Yeah.
I got a blister.
I think it's Sister Irma in the message she brought up. Don't drop the ball.
Yep.
Don't drop the ball.
You're right there
at the finish line, at the touchdown line, and we drop the ball.
Pastor has, in a few occasions, talked about things that are blocking our flow. Right? Mm-hmm. We want rivers of living water to flow.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
But then there's stuff in the way. Rocks. We have to get rid of those things.
River rocks.
Yes.
God bless you. God bless you. That's okay.
Thank you guys for
spending time with us. We're going to get ready to finish up here. But love is kind. Love is patient. Love is gentle. We have to be tender-hearted, forgiving. We have to have self-control. We have to. And yes, when other people see that, things will start to happen.
So this week, before we get, I mean, we're not done with this, we're done with this service right now, but next week's also on the same thing. Little homework for y'all.
Little homework is,
how do you show kindness? How are you going to show kindness within this week towards your loved one?
Mm-hmm.
Not just towards people, towards your loved one, towards your spouse. How are you going to show kindness to them? And how can you make this a daily habit? Discover about love. Did you make today? What discoveries did you make today? And what specifically did you do in this dare? So in this whole week.
Yeah. How are you going to show kindness? And how are you going to make it a habit? Keeping your mouth shut. That's your homework.
Look for more.
There's more ways. So next week. We're going to go round robin. We're just.
Should I make a copy of that and have it?
Like, it's okay.
I'll make it and I'll give it to y'all on Sunday.
You guys have her phone number? Call her. Text her. We are going to finish off with our prayer request like always. Amen. Sister Lisa and her faithful prayer for her mother, for my mother, for this church, all of her family members, which include her brother-in-law Reyes, who's always. He's been going through some health issues for a long time. His wife, Sumiko, and Aiden, Liz, and Julia, who are Lisa's brother's family. Lisa lost her brother here a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
God bless you, Papa. And she's always asking for Tio Tacho. She's asking for Tia Marty and Tio Paul. She's asking for Rose, who was Moses' wife. She's asking for Sister Lydia and family comfort and healing. She's asking for the military members of her family, Stephen, Joshua, Robert, my son Christian, Adrian, for guidance, for strength, for peace on their journey. She's asking for Cousin Paul, Sandy, the parents of and family, for peace, comfort, and healing the loss of their daughter. My cousin Leilani is asking for she has an unspoken request for her family members and a prayer request for Samuel, a young man with cancer in his body. Sister Rosie is asking for her Uncle Max. He's very ill in the hospital, and our family, in Jesus' name, praying for strength so I can be strong for our family. We have God close to me and show the love. Pray for my cousin Monica, you, an angel. She needs our strength. Amen. That's Sister Rosie that comes here. She has a lot of things going on in her family. We're going to uplift her in our prayers. So as we go to the Lord in prayer, just agree with me. Don't leave me alone. We pray for these prayers at the end of our services. And it's an honor to be able to intercede for people, that people would say, can you please pray for me? God already heard it.
Yes.
God already knows the request.
Yes.
There's a prayer request that came in from Sister Rochelle to pray for her granddaughter. Her mom just took her to the emergency.
Amen. So don't leave me alone as we make this prayer request.
We just visit my mom too, and she's been in, Angie said she's been staying in the room depressed.
A little depressed, huh?
Yeah, so, and she can't get over it. She said, so I walked in the room and I said, what's going on, Mom? She said, every time she walks out there, she sees Renee's picture. So I told Angie maybe to
take the picture,
put it aside somewhere, and just for a little bit. You know, I know that Angie wants that picture, but still, like, put it aside so Mom can get out of her room and go. I told her, you need fellowship, Mom. You can't be staying here. So just pray for my mom.
Okay.
Yeah.
Amen. We're gonna keep these prayer requests, and they're gonna be prayed for again on Monday. Like I said, go with me, please. Agree with me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we just come before you right now in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. For there's no other name, Father, that we can come before you, Father. We ask for your authority. We ask for your power, Heavenly Father, that you would send your ministering angels right now, Father, as Pastor says, to the north, south, the east, and the west, Heavenly Father, carrying peace, carrying comfort, carrying strength, Heavenly Father, carrying that healing, Heavenly Father. Those that might find themselves in this state of depression, we come against it and we bind it up in the name of Jesus, Father. We cast it back to the pits of hell where it belongs, Heavenly Father. We ask right now, Father, there's so many people, Father, that are asking for prayer, that are in a state of grieving. They've lost loved ones. Father, I pray for your peace and your spirit to just abide in the presence of their household, in their conversation. Father, I pray that you would send people to just continue to just manifest the Spirit of God and the sweet spirit of peace in the homes of these people that are going through these grieving areas of their lives, Father. Father, you can heal. You still have power, Heavenly Father. You are still on the throne and you are still working miracles in people's lives, Heavenly Father. So I continue to ask, Heavenly Father, for those prayer requests that have come in through the airways, Heavenly Father. You know them already, Father. So we love you. We have confidence and we know, Heavenly Father, the praise report's going to come back, Heavenly Father, that you were there, that you did something, that things took place, Heavenly Father. Your word says that as we bind it on here, it's bound in heaven. When we loose it here, it's loose in heaven, Heavenly Father. So we loosen these things, Heavenly Father. Peace, love. Father, we just thank you, Lord Jesus, for this time, for kindness and for peace and for love in our lives and for our spouses, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you, Father, for what you're doing in this body, Heavenly Father. As we dismiss from this place, but never from your presence, Heavenly Father, go with us, Heavenly Father. Bring us back safely, Father. We'll be back here again on Sunday, Father. I thank you for those that tuned in on Facebook. Be blessed. Have a good evening. Have a good weekend. Be here in Sunday school if you can. And if not, we'll see you on Facebook. In Jesus' name we say amen and amen. God bless you. Amen. Y'all come back now. Abadi, abadi, abadi. That's all, folks. God bless.